Do it in Jesus' name. Thank God for this wonderful time that's given to us again, that we may share and His word. As I say, the word of God is power. When we hear it, it transforms, it changes our lives, and we cannot be the same again after listening to the word of God. And I also pray that we may share what the Lord has for us this day. We thank you, Father, for giving us a wonderful time to listen and hear your word, Lord. I pray that, Lord, you may speak to us. Father, speak, for your servants are listening. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We want to share together our topic, grace of God. You know, we are saved by grace, and we are sustained by grace. I say grace is unmerited favor, or is that empowerment and righteousness. Another way you can say that is divine power of God, divine life, divine ability that flows within us, that we can achieve, or that we can fully authorize that which God has put, that which God has entrusted to us, or that duty, that gives that work that God has bestowed to us to accomplish in this world. You know, many places that Paul spoke much about grace, but we want us to look at what the Master of Grace himself, Jesus, spoke, because one who has dealt much in this area of grace. And you know, as we go through the chapter of John, chapter 8, from verse 1, and as we look at a few points that shows grace of God, how it's explained and outlined in that chapter, we'll be encouraged that we can walk and know that we are not walking by our own strength, it's by grace of God. He has saved by grace, we are sustained by grace, and by grace will make it in this life. Let me read from verse 1. But Jesus went to the mountain of Olives early in the morning. He came against the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and placing her in the midst. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now, the law of Moses commands us to stone such. What do you say about her?" This they say to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his fingers on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone to her." And once more he bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by another, beginning with the eldest to eldest. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus looked up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No, no one, Lord." Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, I do not sin again." This is Jesus. And I want to point a few points here that shows how gracious our Master is, that can encourage us in this walk of grace. First, we see scribes, men of law, men who were well educated in the area of law, or maybe were holier than thou, the society, people that maybe were esteemed, the people who knew and understood religion, brings this woman before Jesus. Say that this one, we have caught him in the very act. What do you think should he do? We know that the law says that we stone him. That's the law. Law says this woman is condemned. What do you say, Master? And here, I see the law being biased, because they say they called this woman very act, but it's brought alone here. And we see biasness in the law. But when he comes, one thing that they bring him in the feet of Jesus, the Master of Grace. Jesus does not condemn the lady, because this grace. Yes, the woman was found in act of adultery, in sin. And by the law, he's supposed to be stoned to death. But he comes before all on the feet of the Master of Grace, Jesus Christ. Number one, here we see biasness. Law is biased, but grace is not biased. Grace does not show favoritism. Grace locates as far as you are ready to receive grace of God. Does not show favor. It will locate you wherever you are. This lady was found in sin. It's brought before grace, the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace is able to locate him. These people thought they were highly, maybe they were better. Grace does not recognize them, because they look down upon this young lady, because she has been found in sin. When you continue to redefine that, they are trying to day, Jesus, what do you say? Can you condemn this lady? Can you say something? We know the law. The law is clear. What's supposed to be done? It's supposed to be stoned to death. What do you say? But you find that master didn't say anything. Kept quiet. But Bible says they continued asking and maybe pressing. Then Jesus stood and told them, if any one of you is sinless, let him be the first one to throw a stone. You see, no one tried to do so. They all left, from the oldest to the youngest. Then the lady was left with Jesus, in the feet of Jesus, in grace. Then Jesus looked up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? She said, no one, Lord. Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go and do not sin again. And this true definition of grace, this lady was in sin, condemned by people. Sin is nothing when it comes before the grace. For that, Jesus saying a very good word, I cannot condemn you, because grace does not condemn. Yes, you are in sin, but he says, in other words, I do not condemn you. In other words, your past is forgiven. Yes, you are in sin, but you come before me. You have dealt before me. Yes, you call that I'm the Lord, because he says, no one, Lord. You call that, yes, you are the Lord. Bible is saying here now, Jesus said, I will not condemn you. I saw your mercy. That's what grace is. Tells him now your past is forgiven. They condemned you. They said bad words about you, but you are forgiven. Just now live and sin no more. In other words, you will be forgiven. You will be washed. You are righteous. I've called it righteous. In future, you should not sin. In other words, the past, forget about it. It was dark. It was in sin. It was something that you cannot want to refer back to, but have blot every sinner forgiven. You are forgiven. You are righteous. Move on. For tomorrow, grace is sufficient. Do not sin. Do not continue in sin. That's what I call future grace. That tomorrow is assured. That you cannot live in sin. You are forgiven. You are now a child. You are right. You are righteous. Therefore, now continue that righteousness. Walk not by your power, not by your might. The Bible says that you are saved by grace, and you continue by grace. Grace teaches us, the book of Titus, chapter 2, the Bible says that the grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness. That the grace that is given this lady, telling him that no from here henceforth. For tomorrow, you are cleansed, you are righteous. For yesterday, you are cleansed, you are righteous. For tomorrow, sin no more. Grace is sufficient. Continue in righteousness. Don't go back to where you are. In other words, you are righteous forever. You will be cleaned forever. This does not mean that if you sin tomorrow, grace will carry you. Grace will sustain you. That's what the Bible says in the book of Jude 24, that is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. That's grace. In other words, that you will be saved. Maybe you are not right, but the grace will carry you through. When you go wrong, it will bring you back to right. It will bring you back to the way. That when time of appearing comes, it will present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. Now this lady walking before the Lord, God is righteous. You are a sinner. There's nothing. There is no effort you have done by yourself to be called righteous. No. It's master. You come before the master. And the master cannot condemn you. Master is that you are forgiven. Yes, your past was dark. Yes, your past was unlovable. But forget about it. For tomorrow, I'll keep you. My grace is sufficient. Though this walk, we don't walk by our own strength, not by our own power. It's powerful. That's why we are saved by grace and we are sustained by grace. The Lord who enables us. Therefore, what should we do as Christians? Let us submit at Lordship and leadership of the Lord. About yesterday, let sin of yesterday not take captive of us. I know the enemy is good in reminding us of the past sins, what where we came from, sins that we did, many things that we went astray, and reminds us of that. Our mother is saying, forget about it. I do not condemn you. I forgive you for all that. And from now, depend on me. Continue in me. That's why I encourage us. That is good in the Lord. He's the master of grace. He's the house of grace. Himself is grace. Therefore, as we are him, as I've said in the book of Titus, Bible says that the grace will teach us to say no to ungodliness. What you call to him will teach us. We'll know. We'll be able to know this sin, this not sin. And find ourselves that we are growing. We are growing more and more like him. He's the master of grace. Then we'll find ourselves growing closer and closer like him. The voice said in the book of Jude, Bible says that he's able to keep us from falling. So the only thing way that we can abstain from sin, you can fully live a righteous life. It's not by our own strength. We cannot boast about righteousness because we are obtained through Him, Christ Jesus. Therefore, we cannot remain righteous if we continue in Him, if we continue walking in Him. Therefore, the Bible says that He's able to keep us. He will keep us from falling and present us faultless in His presence with exceeding joy and faultless. May God bless us. We are beset by grace. Let us continue this grace, and this grace will take us home. Father, I bless you for your word. You know that you have saved us by your grace, and by your grace will sustain us. Father, sustain us that we may remain in you. At the end of it, O Lord, we may gain eternal life. We bless you, Father, and exalt your name. In Jesus' name. Amen.